We welcome you all to the training session 3 of national level virtual training on DNA barcoding. Now I request Ms. Nikita George, Assistant Professor, Department of Zoology, Lady Doak College, to introduce the resource person for this session.
Good morning. I am happy to introduce the next speaker for this training program. A very much sought after expert in the field of bioinformatics, Dr. A. Mahalakshmi, Assistant Professor in the Department of Zoology at Lady Doak College. Dr. Mahalakshmi graduated from Lady Doak College and then went on to complete her master's, an advanced diploma in bioinformatics, and her doctoral studies from the Madurai Kamaraj University. Speaking for her research expertise, she has about 18 journal publications and 4 book chapters to her credit. Dr. Mahalakshmi's research work has been funded from various prestigious institutions like that of the UGC and DST-CERB. In 2005, she was awarded the CSIR Travel Fellowship for Young Women Scientists for presenting her research work at the 3rd International Symposium on Biocontrol and Biotechnology held at China. In addition to serving as an organizing member and a resource person for the UGC NRCBS Summer or Winter School, Dr. Mahalakshmi has served as resource person for several workshops to offer her expertise in the domains of immunology, bioinformatics, microbial biotechnology, and plant genomics. It is indeed very evident from this abridged introduction that a training on DNA barcoding would be incomplete without the expertise from Dr. Mahalakshmi. Dear ma'am, we look forward to listening to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Nikita ma'am, for your nice words of introduction. Good morning, participants. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. So we'll start the session with the ITIS database. Let me present my PPT. What I'll be doing is, I'll just give you an overview and then we'll continue with the practical session. So the way I wish to handle the session is, whatever sequences that I am demonstrating, you can do it with the sequence that you have in your hand. Or otherwise, I am having a set of sequences, I can put it in the chat box or share it in your mails. Participants, is it okay? Yes, I'm presenting my screen. Kindly let me know whether it is visible. Is the screen visible?
No, ma'am.
Not visible. Is the screen visible?
No, ma'am.
No?
Yeah, it's visible.
It's visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, thank you. So let me start my lecture with the quotes of Amit Ray, wherein God is dancing in our breath, singing in our thoughts, and celebrating in our DNA. When you understand that, God hears, evaporates, and eternity arises. So now we are going to do our DNA barcoding analysis. I'll start with my introduction. So here, the first website that I wanted all of you to go is, you can just copy this website in the browser, and I just wanted you to do this steps. That is, say, for example, can I put it in the chat box for you? Participants, please. I wanted a two-way approach because it's a hands-on session. Only if you interact, it will be really useful to you.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, I'll put it in the chat. Yes, I'm putting the link in the chat. Yes, I wanted you to visit this website. So what you can do is, when you visit this website, I wanted you to select the group that you are interested in. All of you are able to go to that website?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. This is an integrative taxonomic information system which gives a hierarchical report. Say, for example, you are a beginner to the taxonomy. So I just wanted to have the reliable information on the species name and the hierarchical classification. I can just go to this database link. So here, if you are interested in an animal group, you can just highlight the Animalia. One second, I'll put it in my print screen so that you can also try parallelly. Yes, you can try it parallelly. So if you are interested in the animal kingdom, just click on the animal kingdom and the order. And I wanted you to check whether you are able to take the hierarchy. So in this example, I have taken an example of a Lepidopteran order, just showing what is the different classification. Yes, participants, can you do it for your interested organism or taxon? Able to retrieve?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Okay. So this is a basic information wherein we'll be getting access to the hierarchical classification. The flow of my talk will be like this. We'll start with the electronic PCR, and then already Sujata ma'am, Noord ma'am has given you an extensive practical session on polymerase chain reaction. So we imagine that we have done a PCR for our own taxon, and then Vanirajan sir has given an overview of the DNA sequencing. The entire process is clear to you. So we'll continue with we start with electronic PCR, and then after a PCR is over for a particular gene of interest, we go proceed with the DNA sequencing. This is for the continuity of the analysis to be followed. So after the DNA sequencing, we get the sequence. So the sequence quality will be checked, and I'll be just demonstrating what all analysis we can do with the DNA sequence. This is the full overview of my lecture. Any doubts, please stop me now and then. Okay. So this is an electronic PCR concept wherein we have just the primer. I have a forward primer and I have a reverse primer. So what I do, I search these primers against the sequence present in the database. If I search against the database, I have two possibilities. Either it can be a continuous word, but it will not be, no matches will be there. But it can be a discontinuous word. Discontinuous words is wherein gaps are permitted, it can be a match. So these are the different possibilities that is possible. So you have the primer. So you might ask me a question, ma'am, where do we get these primers? The primers, we can get it from the publication. Say, for example, I am interested in an earthworm species. I can try to take what are all the cytochrome oxidase primers that is available for earthworms. Okay, and then I can search against the earthworms and see against the earthworm sequence which is available in the database and try to see whether I am getting the amplicon. Trying to see whether the primer is able to bind to the sequence. So sequence is already available in the database. Is this clear? The sequence is there in the database. We take the primers and then do a database search, trying to see whether the primer is binding to the sequence. If it is binding to the sequence, we just calculate what is the length between the primer 1 and primer 2 and calculate the PCR product. Am I clear, participants? Am I
yes, ma'am.
Yes, thank you.
Yes.
So this primer, for your analysis, I have just taken these primers. I can copy these primers and put it in the chat so that you can try and do the same. Okay. So here, this is a primer which I have taken from the paper. It's a Lepidopteran primer. I'll put it in the chat so that you'll be able to do it parallelly. The first one is a forward primer and the second one is a reverse primer. I'll teach you a technique wherein you can copy both together and do a database search and try to find out what is the PCR amplicon. One second. So what we normally do is, whenever we do a primer search, what we do is we try to copy the first one is a forward primer. I'm just spacing it here just for you to understand how this analysis is being done. Okay. And then what you do, you continuously type N's. N is just a set of sequences wherein you're just giving the spaces. We can do it two ways. We can do a separate forward primer search and we can do a separate reverse primer search and then see which organism has both the primers matched. But if you do like that, it will be a difficult task. So now I'm giving you a shortcut method wherein you can just take the forward primers and then just type stretches of N. N is just for spaces in between and then again you type the reverse primer. One second. Keep this file ready, then I'll go with the next. You can copy this and put it in the notepad. Am I making sense? We are doing the concept of electronic PCR, wherein you are taking the forward primer sequence and then in between you are typing stretches of N. It can be just 20 or 30, whichever N you want. N is just we are leaving some spaces for the reverse primer to go. Yes, you can see it in the chat. The top one is the forward primer. In between, I have added stretches of nucleotides. And then the end is a reverse primer. Okay. So now, what is the next step is, you have to go to the BLAST N. Shall I demonstrate it here? All of you are familiar with the BLAST N? Are you here, participants?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
So I'm going to demonstrate in the Internet Explorer. I'm just presenting my screen. I'll just copy and so all of you can copy this. All of you can copy this and keep it in a notepad for you to proceed with the analysis. Okay. So I'll also keep it in the notepad. You can keep it in a notepad or in a Word, whichever way you want. It's always advisable to use notepads for saving sequences. I just copied the sequence that I put in the chat. Okay. Now you are able to see my screen. You just go into net. Just going to type in Google NCBI BLAST. The entire step is given in the manual tutorial also for you to.
Ma'am.
Now only it's presenting.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. So here I just typed NCBI BLAST N. So this BLAST is a basic local alignment search tool which is used to identify the sequence similarity. So as it is a primer sequence, you are selecting BLAST N. BLAST N is a nucleotide BLAST wherein the query that we put is a primer sequence and it will search against the nucleotide database. Okay. So I'm just clicking on nucleotide BLAST. So all these steps are given in the manual also. And whatever sequences I have typed in the chat, no, that I have put it here. Able to see? Enter accession number or FASTA sequences. I have just pasted the sequences that you need to search. And then I'm just searching the nucleotide collection. But for a primer search, you should use somewhat similar sequences. It's not highly similar sequences. Okay. Can I move down? Yes. So I'm just clicking on BLAST. Parallelly, you can also do so that you will get a feel of performing the work if you are connected in a laptop or otherwise, you can note down the flow step, flow chart representation. So the BLAST has been submitted. So this is a page wherein it says our query has been submitted. Okay, so here you can see why this problem comes is I have submitted somewhat similar. So the option is it has to be highly similar sequences. Megablast has to be chosen for a primer. Yes. You're able to see the results? What happened? One second. So here we have to spell out the organism name also. So here in this case I have taken Lepidoptera. So what I am going to do is I am just going to type in the organism ID. I can just type Lepidoptera. Yes. And then I can give somewhat similar sequences. Yes, ma'am. We need to refine our search accordingly. So here you are able to see it has shown this many sequences are showing match with the primer sequence. So in this case I have just typed both the forward and reverse primer. So I can just look into the alignment. Yes, here you can see it's only showing the forward alone. I have to look down the sequence wherein I'm getting both the sequences together. Why I'm getting only one? Any idea? Participants? Why only one alignment is shown? I have put two primers. Yes? I'm purposely have done a mistake so that you can also note it down. See? It you should have at least just 10 to 20 ends. It's not a problem. Let me try once more. You are doing it parallelly, participants?
Yes, ma'am.
So let me show my slide. I'll show you. That's already been done. You're able to see my PPT?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. So here you can see the analysis that I have done yesterday night. I could see the primers that I have when I submitted for the search. The query is binding from 88. Okay, the query is the primer sequence that I have put. And the subject sequence is a sequence that it has picked up from the database. Okay. So here, can you locate the forward primer and reverse primer? Yes. Anyone have an idea about the primer sequence? TATT is your forward primer and TAA. You will not be getting the exact match, but you'll be getting an idea where the primer is binding. Okay. This is what I'm just showing it to you in your BLAST results also. One second, I'll go to that explorer page. So when you look at the graphical summary, it shows the score is very less. We'll be touching upon the score later. So why it is very less? Because it's a very short sequence only. Okay. So coming to your alignment, only one match is there. So when I use these primers, will I be able to amplify? Participants, please respond. This is a genome sequence which is already available. For a PCR to amplify, both the primers should bind to the DNA. So when I have done the BLAST search, it's just showing one alignment alone. What does it mean? Will it amplify? Participants, please respond. I hope you will be aware about the basics of PCR. For a PCR, we'll be using a forward primer and a reverse primer. Forward primer will bind to one end of the sequence, and the reverse primer will bind to the other end of the sequence. In between the PCR, in between the forward primer and reverse primer binding only, the amplification will occur. You agree with me?
Yes, ma'am.
So in this case, what is that has to be done is, we need to check for other alternative primers also. Otherwise, what you can do is, here what I have done, I have just clicked on, what is the tool that I mentioned? Blastian. I can just go. So this has to be altered accordingly. So here, I have just taken Blastian. I have given Lepidoptera tax ID as organ. So it will search against Lepidopteran alone, because I don't want the entire organism group to be amplified. And then, instead of somewhat similar sequences, we can check whether it is getting in highly similar sequences, or you can also check in more dissimilar sequences. Okay, so in this case, only one primer is bound and it will not be getting the amplification. I have to check in all the three categories and try to see whether I am getting the primers, forward primers and reverse primers, binding in the DNA sequence at two different regions. See, when I put there, it's saying no significant similarity. In such a case, such sort of primers cannot be used for PCR. Okay, then what is the next step? What can we do? Yes, I have to check whether I have copied the entire one, whether the sequence that I have copied is correct. One second, let me do it from here. The sequence that I put in your chat only, I'm just copying. So how will we get these primers, participants? For example, you are a new researcher, you are now just going to amplify, you have got a new isolate, you just wanted to confirm what is that organism. So what will be the strategy that you can follow to find out the primers? Yes, please respond. So here you can see, I put the forward primer top, I mean in the bottom I put the reverse primer. That's the chances of N. Maybe I would have put excess N, I believe. Not a problem, but okay. So I just put the nucleotide sequence. Here I can give PCR primers. And then it's nucleotide collection. Here I put Lepidopteran tax ID. Maybe the Lepidopteran tax ID that I mentioned is not working. Maybe I can check, is there any other Lepidoptera group that is being given? See, they have so many Lepidopteran groups. We can try it with some other groups also. If I'm clear about the bold numbers, I can take a particular bold. Otherwise, it's always advisable to use general one, then only we'll be able to work on a particular group. Okay, so I have selected this organism. The idea of selecting the organism is I am narrowing down my search. Imagine I'm not using Lepidoptera. Let us see what happens. You're able to get my idea without Lepidoptera. What it will do, it will search for the entire database. So here I'm just trying that also. I'm just taking highly similar sequence. The technique is very simple. The idea is you should understand why you are doing and for what purpose you are doing it. That's all. The same blast can be used for different purposes. When I choose that, what happens? No significant similarity found. Okay. So what is that I have given? I have given mega blast. Okay. Let me check with the other set of primers. One second. The same steps have been given in your manual also. You can use it in the manual also. We are given another set of primers also. I'm just projecting the manual. You're just going to the Blastian. So this is a primer. This is another set of primer. Just copying the primers. Yes, and then stretches of N. And then yes, so I just copy the primers. I just given nucleotide collection. I just wanted to know for which organisms it's binding. Okay, just the primers alone I given. I just given nucleotide collection. So here kindly note down. So whenever you choose the program, we can give the organism tax ID or otherwise you can leave it simple. Okay, here the primers that I have shown here for the manual, we have used the earthworm. Okay. And then you should also select, yes, just typing somewhat similar sequence, highly similar sequences. So before proceeding, say for example, I have to order a set of primers, I have to check whether my primer is binding with the organism of interest. Okay, so here you can see I given a general search. Okay, then I might be interested to know for what all organisms it is binding. So for that you can just click on this, the top one, all are showing 100% identity. So here you can just click on this to have an idea to which organisms this primer is binding. Okay, it's showing some name. So if you are a new user, you can just go to the taxonomy. So here it says it binds to eukaryota, metazoa, arthropoda, arachnida. All these classification will be given. Okay, so this is a primer which is binding with the insects and mites. This has been published in that particular paper. So these primers can be used for mites also. Okay, so by looking at this, we can get an idea what is the organism that it is binding. Okay, say for example, it is binding to mites. What about if I am using an earthworm? So in such a case, what we do, we have to narrow down the search. Maybe you can go down a little and say, check what are all the other organisms it is binding. Okay, or yes, I'll show you. One second. So this is another accession number. This is another bitter link, the insect that is being chosen. So this has been published by the National Biodiversity Information Network. So before proceeding with the primers, we need to check to what all organisms this primer binds. So by this analysis, we will know to which organism it is binding. Okay. Then I need to check the primer size. What will be the PCR product? Okay. One second. I'll go to the graphic summary. So here you can see the match is more. When I showed you the earlier one, the matches were in the range of blue. That indicates the score is less. But here, if the match the score is in the green, that indicates it's having a higher score and the match is a bit higher. Okay. So these primers, if I need to check where it is binding, here you can see. You're able to see 40 to 65. So 40 to 65 is your forward primer and it is binding with the subject 659 to 634. Okay, then I need to see where is the reverse primer binding. Okay, one second. Let me see anywhere whether I'm able to see the alignment being loaded. So the same primer can be used for all these organisms. That idea is clear. The next step is I just wanted to know, say if it's showing 100% identity, it means it is exactly binding. Okay. So in this case, as we have given highly similar sequences, it has just taken the forward primer alone as bound. Okay. The next approach, what you can do is you can do a separate reverse primer search and do that also. Here it's not showing two alignments, together. So you can just note down in this example, you can just say the query is your forward primer. The subject is, I'll just take a print screen for you to later calculate. See, in this case, the primer that I have used is a forward primer. It is binding to the query. The query is the primer sequence that you have used, and the subject sequence is a sequence that it has picked up from the database. Okay, so here the number refers to the position. So here you can see it is aligning from 40 till 65, from 659 to 634. Maybe 659 you can keep it as a thing, and the organism that it has picked up is, so here as it is showing only the forward, I'll again go to the reverse separately. Able to understand the concept? Yes. I'll show you another approach also. One second. So here you can see all these organisms, the primer is binding from this region. These are the set of organisms where it is binding. Maybe you can go to these accession numbers and check what is the organism wherein this primer is binding. Okay, the primer is T double A. Can someone tell me what, whether it is a forward primer or a reverse primer? T double A. It's a reverse primer. I have taken it from the manual, I believe. One second.
Reverse primer.
Reverse primer. Thank you, ma'am. Yes. So the reverse primer is binding. So now I'm going to search with the forward primer. As it's not showing when I do it a single search, I'm just going to the, let me keep these results also. BLASTian. So I'm just facing the forward primer alone. I'm just given nucleotide collection. The previous one I did not narrow down, no, it was a general search. Yes. So here also I'm just doing a BLAST. So before it searching, for the participants to note, kindly note whatever sequence that we are searching is referred to as the query sequence, and the sequence that it picks up from the database is called as the subject. So here in the electronic PCR, what we are doing, we are trying to see where the forward primer binds and where the reverse primer binds, and in between you have to find out an organism wherein the primers are binding to the same gene. Then only it will be easy for you to calculate. Okay. So here, as I showed you the previous one, see, this primer is having a gray score 50 to 80. That's why it's having a green shade and the alignment. Okay. So this is a, one second. I need to find out the organism. For your analysis, I have just shown a sequence. I'll go to that. Maybe later you can search and find it out. I'll show it in a PowerPoint just for you to understand. So here, participants are able to see the PPT. So this primer only I have searched with the method that I have adopted. That is using your NCBI BLASTian. I have used the Mega Blast, and then it has shown the primers, and I went for the alignment. So here for this sequence, it is showing two alignments. Okay, the two alignment you can see, the query is from 88 to 113, and then the other one is 34 to 25. So the 3 to 25 will be the forward primer, and 88 to 113 is the reverse primer. So how will you calculate the product size? You can just calculate. See, what you can do is the same genome. It's showing. See here, you can see concept. The same organism. So what you can do is you can just calculate 11440 minus 12121. Can someone calculate and tell me what is the difference between them? This is the lowest 11440 that was taken from the subject, and it is aligning till 12146. That is the largest position. Please calculate and tell me what is the difference among them. Yes, participants, please respond. Able to follow what I am saying? Yes or no?
Yes, ma'am, we are able to follow.
Can someone tell me what's the difference between the bases? Just differentiate minus 12, 146 minus 11, 440. You understand why I am saying that? Yes? Yes or no?
Maha is nearly 1000, Maha. 1006.
1006, huh? I just calculate. Let me put the calculator. I'm not able to do. You have to see. Someone put it in the calculator and tell me. I hope you understand the concept. The calculation, you can do it later. It's not a problem. The idea is you should understand the concept. $12,146 minus $11,440. The amplicon size is 706. It is a theoretical calculation wherein the primers go and bind to the same genome. So forward primer one end it will bind and reverse primer it will bind, and that is being shown in the NCBI blast results. Okay. And then what I do, I look at the alignment and then I try to compare what is the difference between them. Based on it, we predict the amplicon size. Am I clear? Are you able to do this? Parallelly you are doing it?
Yes, ma'am.
So this is how the way how we calculate the product size of the amplicon. Then you might ask me a question, ma'am, if the genome is not available, what can we do? Yes? I'm taking a primer. It's a novel isolate. You say, ma'am, no one has done this. In such a case, what we can do is we can take related organisms gene. You need not take the entire genome. You can just take whatever gene that I have targeted as a PCR primer, and I can check with the gene, try to see where in the gene this binds. It's a simple technique. Just take the primer, try to blast it against the sequence, and then check whether it is able to bind. Can I move on to the next technique? Next tool that is used? If you do it parallelly, you will be able to understand. Yes. I hope as you are silent, I hope you are able to follow. Can I move on?
Yes, ma'am.
The next thing, as I mentioned, we have designed the primer. I'll go to the workflow. You can see we have designed, we have checked the electronic PCR, and then I'm a bit positive in that. I've just ordered the primers, and I'm a bit lucky. I have optimized the PCR and I got the PCR amplicon, and the amplicon has been sent to sequencing. Maybe Vanirajan sir has sequenced the samples and I got the sequence results. So now I am taking you to check how we are going to do about the sequence analysis. I hope you understand this workflow, participants.
No. Yes, ma'am, it is clear.
Okay. So now I am taking the tool that we have to use for checking the sequences. Okay. So there is a tool called as codon code aligner. Okay. I'm just going to play a video how it is being used. One second. What is the tool? Codon code aligner. What is the purpose of using this tool? Just to check the forward sequence. Normally, whenever we go for sequencing, we have to do both the forward runs and reverse runs. Can someone tell me why should we go for the forward runs and reverse runs? Why can't we do only the forward runs alone? Yes. If I do both the runs, it will be bit costly, no? Why should I go with the sequencing of both the forward runs as well as reverse runs? No idea, ma? Okay. I'll just play the video. The idea is only when you do a forward run and reverse run, we'll be able to check the problems in sequencing. Sometimes certain ends will not be sequenced properly. When I do both the forward runs and reverse runs, I'll be able to confirm whatever sequence that I got is correct. Okay. So I'll just taking you to the codon code aligner tool, wherein it's just giving a demo. Then I'll demonstrate how that sequence can be used. One second. So this is the codon code aligner. So this needs license, but to work with, you can continue with the trial. You are able to see the code-on-code aligner tool? It's present in
yes,
the screen?
ma'am.
No, one second. I'm just presenting it again. So now I'm taking you to the next analysis, wherein you are going to check the sequence quality, whether the forward and reverse runs are matching. Okay. So before going into the code-on-code aligner, let me show you how the sequences will be when I get it from the sequencing service. Okay. So here, normally when we get the sequences, I'm just showing the fold one second. We will be getting the forward runs and reverse runs. Screen is not visible, one second. Yes, Kalaivani? Yes. What is the difference between range 1 and range 2? Range 1 indicates, yes, I'll go to that alignment. One second. Range 1 and range 2 is the same primer aligning in the same genome. Forward primer is aligning to one region and the reverse primer is aligning to the different region. That is why it is being shown as range 1 and range 2. So normally whenever you wanted to calculate electronic PCR, our primer should bind to the same genome. Only if it is forward primer is binding to one region and reverse primer is binding to another region, we'll be able to calculate the product that is amplified after using these primers. Kalaivani ma'am, have I answered your question?
Yes ma'am, thank you ma'am.
Thank you. So now we are moving on to the code-on-code aligner. I'll just show you how what will be the files that we get after we send it for sequencing. One second. I'm just showing the sequences. One second. You're able to see? So normally when it will take some time. You're able to see it showing how you're sharing. You're able to see? So here, this file I have just downloaded. So whenever we send it for sequencing, this I cannot give it to you because it is an unpublished sequence. But just for the analysis, I'm just showing for the users. For those who are already familiar, please bear with me. For students, for the sake of students, I'm just showing. So here you can see you'll be getting a FASTA file. FASTA file is the sequence, okay? ABI file will be the chromatogram. I'll just show you that a little bit later. I'll just show. ABI file, normally we have to use the code-on-code aligner tool to check. So here we have sent a sequence and the sequence is available here. Okay. So now I hope you are able to follow me. Or flow, you're able to follow the flow of the analysis is being processed. Participants, otherwise I shouldn't be talking something which is Greek and Latin to you. So I got the sequence file. So now I'm just going to teach you how that code-on-code aligner can be used. This code-on-code aligner, you can just type. I'm just typing it here. You can just type in the Google. I have already downloaded, but you can, if you want, I can demonstrate it. One second. I'm just closing this NCBI Blast. One second. You're able to see the web page that I'm typing. Code-on-code aligner. The screen is visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Please respond. Now and then I'm moving now and then. No. So if you respond, you will be with me. I will be with you. So here, this is a code-on-code aligner tool, which is available. So here, what we do, we have to download for Windows. So if I click on this, I already downloaded it. Just for the sake of the participants, I'm just teaching the steps to be followed. So here, what you are doing, you have to just download code-on-code aligner for Windows. Okay. If I have downloaded, you can see in my download page, you'll be getting a code-on-code aligner. I have downloaded it already and I have already installed it. And that installation, after installation, I'll be getting a file like this.
I don't know how to show this, whether it's seen.
The screen should be visible. Ah, yes, thank you. So here you can see it is a licensed server, but they give some trial period. Yesterday I downloaded it so that you can also download it today and you can use it for another 29 days, 30 days it is visible, I believe. So here, what we do, we open a project, okay? So whenever we start with the code on code aligner, we have to create a new project. Yes? Here you can see file, import, add samples. I have just kept two files here. Yes, I have kept two files here. I just taken those files, opening it here. And then what you have to do is, you have to go to, normally, say for example, I have a new sequence. What normally we do is, we take some reference sequence also. Why we take a reference sequence is, reference sequence is similar to a positive control, wherein we just try to compare how best our sequence is aligning with the reference sample. So here I'm just importing the samples. Reference, I already downloaded and kept. Okay, so when you are taking the reference sequence, we should tell the program what is the reference sequence. One second, let me select that reference sequence. So here, I just click on it and then tell the tool that is the reference sequence to be followed. So here, make reference sequence. You might ask me a question, ma'am, I don't want any reference sequence. That can also be done. But what normally we do is, we try to take receive the sequence from the sequencer. We keep some reference sequence for our analysis just to know whether there is a difference in the reference sequence. And then we need to check the sequence quality. Okay. After that, what you have to do is go to contact, advanced assembly. This is not given in your manual. It's just for you to work with if you have the sequence data. So here, before selecting the sequences, it has to be selected, okay? Just selecting the sequence. Contact, advanced assembly. Or no, ma'am, I don't want to do the advanced assembly. I just wanted to align to reference sequence. It's up to the choice of the user. Yes, assembly in groups. And then we have to define the name paths, define names. We can give the guest name scheme, preview. Okay, it gives the name. So it gives, this is being given this particular name. Okay. Okay, assemble. I'm repeating context. We can just go with assemble. Abdi panala. Abdi na na ho abdi na. It is just does not take into groups. It just assembles the sequence and gives you. There are different ways of assembling. To start with, you can just start with assemble. And then after you are familiar with the tool, then you can go with the advanced assembly. Okay. And then say for example, I have got a sequence. I don't know whether the sequence is correct. I just wanted to see whether it is assembling with all of the sequences. You can use the existing tools, muscle and the other tools. We can use assemble with muscle also. So there are different approaches to be followed. What is the purpose of doing this assembly? Why we should do this assembly? I just draw an example here, just show you. Show you that tutorial also. So here you have forward run. You have forward run sequence. Forward run sequence, and then reverse run sequence. What we are to do, we are doing is we are trying to match both the sequences. That is what happens in your assembly. So when we align both, it will check if there are any base pairs and it will give. Okay, I'll show you an example with the newbie. There they'll demonstrate how it is being done. One second. So here, this is you are able to see the electrophorogram.
Yes.
So here you can see the green color. Whenever I use the codon code aligner, the green color refers the sequence quality is bit. It's not clear. When it is no green, it indicates it's of high quality. You can see the peaks are very good. So you don't have green color. So whenever there is green color, that is discrepancy in the sequences. So this is the trace file. Trace file is the electrophorogram, the chromatogram that you get after your sequencing. So you send the PCR sample for sequencing. After sequencing, they will give you this trace file. So we need to check. Okay, we need to check whether the sample is okay. So normally we have different ways of assembly. Is one is you use the advanced assembly wherein we work in groups, or what you can do is you can just select a sequence and then ask it to assemble. So it will just check with the forward and reverse together and it will give you a contig. What is contig? Any idea what is a contig? Contig is it assembles the forward and reverse run, and then it gives a consensus sequence. Consensus sequence is a sequence wherein you are getting a matching in both the regions. Here you can see a contig 1 has been given. Here I can show you the diagram. You're able to see contig is it has assembled all the sequences and it has given a base wherein all are matching. Yes, some places it's giving D. It means that it can be T, G or A. Participants, you are able to follow me? Yes, you're getting a sequence, a raw file, and from the raw file I'm generating a contig. A contig is a in this case it's a consensus sequence. Consensus sequences wherein the sequences are seen for conservation, wherein the peaks are all matching, you get a conserved file. Okay, with the contigs you can proceed with the analysis. You can build a tree, you can find mutations, all this you can do it. I'll just show you one thing. So here Reginald sir, in his lecture he was demonstrating the different types of trees. So using your codon code aligner also you can go with generating the trees. Okay, so here I'm just chosen the neighbor joining tree. Okay, so here what is the problem that he's asking is it should be at least greater than 20 bases. The contig generated here is very less. Okay, so here for this lab we are not going to use the codon code aligner for generating the tree. I'll show you other softwares which is very user friendly. So just now kindly note how codon code aligner can be used just to go with the assembling the sequence. Yes, clear? Can I proceed to the next part of this analysis? To sum up, maybe for the participants' benefit, I again start. We started with the electronic PCR, wherein we have just blasted the primer sequence and you have checked where in the genome the primer sequence is bound, and then you are able to calculate the PCR. Once the PCR, we have done the PCR in the wet lab, and then we have got the sequencing results. Once we get the sequencing results, we proceed with the codon code aligner just to align the forward and reverse run. We get an assembled sequence. Assembled sequence, you get the cont is generated out of the codon code aligner. Okay, so now we have got the sequence in our hand. Yes, can I proceed, participants? This codon code aligner is an extra step which is not been given in the manual. If needed, you can use it. Okay, so we have finished with the BLASTian results. I got the sequence. Okay, the next step, what will be the next step after you get the sequence? Participants, please respond. Can you get your only based on your input, it will be really yes, participants. I need some responses in the chat just to make sure I am in tune with you. Yes, thank you, Kalai ma'am and Jelena Rani ma'am, Irene. Yes, okay, Jacinta. Thank you, Sujata ma'am. Okay, yes. So once we get the sequence, can anyone tell me what is that we need after we get the sequence? I got a sequence, a raw file with me. I have checked both the forward and the reverse runs. What is the next step that we can do? We have heard lectures for the past 2 days. Can someone tell me what is that has to be done next? Thank you, Rabia, Merlina, Inisha, and Shraddha Hivarle. Yes. You have heard two or three days lecture. We have the sequence. The next thing is we need to check to which organism the sequence that we are having in our hand is matching. What's the tool that we can use for that purpose? I have already demonstrated it. You might not feel bored again if I'm saying the same BLAST, but here we'll be using a larger sequence. Yes, for one sequence also we have to proceed with the BLASTian. Okay, so what we do, we go to the BLAST. I'll just demonstrate, but here we give a larger sequence. One second, let me go to that screen. I'm going to edit my search. So instead of the primer sequence, I'm going to give another sequence. Yes, all of you are having a sequence, or shall I put some sequences in the chat for you to proceed? I gave the few of the students a homework. I sent it to your mail. Are any one of you able to retrieve the sequence? Specifically, students. Okay, so not a problem. I have certain sequences in my hand. Maybe I can post those sequences in the chat. You can proceed with those sequences. Okay, say for example, you have got a after you have checked your sequence assembly, I'm putting two sequences. What you are going to do is you are going to parallelly do the analysis with me, and then you are going, yes, Merlina, you can proceed with the sequence. Good, Merlina. Yes, so you have pasted sequence one. You can try with the analysis. Okay, and then I also have another sequence. Okay, paste both, I believe. Okay, not open. One second. I have pasted two sequences together. It should not be done. When you do like this, it will show some errors, or it will not match. Same sequence will be showing. This is sequence one. Let me do it. So here, whenever we do our search, no, we should use this greater than symbol, which is an identifier for the sequence. One second. I'm putting it in the chat. Yes, the sequence alone you can use. So what you are doing? I'm going to just go to the NCBI BLAST. I'm going to edit. Yes. So what I am going to do is, whatever sequence that I'm given you, I'm just trying so that you can also do it parallelly. Are you able to see the screen? Yes. Just the nucleotide sequence, nucleotide collection. Here I'm not trying to restrict the organism. It is an unknown sequence. I got the sequencing results. I just wanted to know to which organism it is similar. Okay. Here I have to give highly similar sequences, because when I wanted to assign to which organism this organism might be, I have to give highly similar sequences. Okay, just give BLAST. Yes, so here you can see it is aligning with these sequences. So here it has 100, as I have taken these sequences from the database, it is showing 100% identity. Imagine this sequence is not taken from the database, if it is showing 99.6%, in such case also it is the same organism. So I wanted to know what is that organism. You can click on this accession number. So here the word of caution, what I wanted you to notice, let me finish this part. Okay, so here I just clicked on this organism. The sequence that I have taken is a cytochrome oxidase subunit gene. Okay, it is showing 99% with this tetragma J. What is this? Can someone find out and tell me what is this organism? It belongs to the Lepidoptera. Okay, so that's a, for example, I'm new to taxonomy, I'm not aware about it. What you can do is you can just go to the taxon link. So I just clicked on the taxon link. It shows it belongs to the moth group. Okay, apart from that, you can go and visit the tree of life, tree of base database. I'm just going to click on this. You're able to see it in the meeting link. So this is a web page wherein they give access to all the organism. What is that name? Tetragma. T-E. What is name that is given there? Tetragma J. Okay. It's not shown in that tree. Maybe you can browse the tree of life. Okay. This you can do it outside. It's not relevant to the tool analysis, but it's an extra reading which you can do it. So here you understand the sequence that I have is related to this particular group. Okay. So you might ask me a question, on what basis we decide which is the taxon, whether it is a novel organism or it is an isolate which is already available. So here, if it is showing 90 above, that is 97, here this is a query coverage. Can you tell me what you mean by query coverage? See, for example, here you can see the top one is the query sequence. Persons are able to see the graphical display. The top one is the query sequence, and all other sequences are sequences that is picked up from the database. The query coverage is trying to say how best it is aligning with the sequence. For the taxon identification, we are not worried about the query coverage. We have to look into the account only the percentage of identity. This column you have to take into account. Okay. So if it is in the range of 97%, it implies that you have identified a novel organism. So here, before confirming this 97% identity, we have to do the codon-code aligner. Only if you have assembled there, only if you are sure the sequences of correct, it has been paired with the both forward and reverse primer, and then it is showing 97% identity, it can be taken, it can be considered. Sometimes there will be sequencing error, you don't do the codon code aligner, just like that you do this analysis, they will question you, they will ask whether you have aligned for both the forward and reverse run. Only if you have aligned both the forward and reverse run, then it is showing the range of 97%, it means it is a novel isolate. In that isolate, you can submit it in the GenBank or you can submit it in the BOLD database. Am I clear? You have got the sequence. You have just done the BLASTian results. We have got the similarity. We also have to look at the E value. The E value should be in the range of 0. It should not be 1 or 2. When it is having the range of 1 or 2, it means it is a random match. Normally, biologically, significant sequences will be having E values in the range of 0 only. Here you can look at the alignments. Here you can see There are different ways of alignment. This is an alignment view pairwise. This is the query anchor dots for identities, wherein you can see. So here you can see, this is your query sequence. Okay. And these are the other sequence. So before going for submission, I have to check, see, in my sequence, this particular stretch is NN. So if it is NN, they will not accept. I don't know whether it has been a for 1 second. Let me see. The stretches of N which I haven't removed. No, I have copied a new sequence. And you know, yes. So here there is no NN, but only in the results it's showing. So what I have to do is, I have to go to the sequence and check. Yes. So here you can see, I have to check manually whether the sequence chromatogram there in that particular position is correct. If it is of good quality, this percentage can be taken into account and that can be used for further submission. So the sequence plays an important role in the analysis. So before proceeding with the sequence analysis, I need to check the sequence quality, check whether the peaks are correct. We can use the code-on-code aligner. We can check the alignments, check with all other sequences, whether all other sequences have the same thing. Is this a sequencing error? If it is a sequencing error, I cannot say this is a normalized state. I need to check it personally and then I can proceed with the submission. Am I made myself clear? A novel organism is an organism which shows percentage identity in the range of 95. If it is showing 100% identity, it means already the sequence is there. It is a duplicate entry. It's not a novel one. Yes, just loading. Just show you that alignment alone. Yes, can I proceed to the next part? So here you can see. So here you can see all other organisms in this position, it is T. So how will we know what is this position? Here you can see, you have to count from this region. You have to count and then see what is this position and then check in the sequence and see whether it is the aligning with all other sequences in that range. So here also you can see this position. Say for example, this is 61, range of 75 or something. Our sequence is having T. All of the sequences are having C or A. So we have to check it and then see, confirm it is not a sequencing error. Then we can proceed with all the analysis. Okay. The sequence checking plays an important role. If we have not done it perfectly, all other analysis that we do is a waste. Even if you go for publication, they will not accept. They'll ask for the trace file and then they'll also check whether it has been aligning. Then it will not be valid. Am I clear? Merlina had a question. Bacterium is strain 16S ribosomal RNA gene. Yes, Merlina, you have a question, Merlina. Merlina, I'm not able to get the message that you have typed in the chat. You wanted to ask me something? So here it is showing 97% identity. Am I correct? No, ma'am, I just shared the result. Okay. Thank you. Thank you for your sharing. I hope as Merlina is sharing, all of the participants are able to follow the analysis. It's just a blast, but we do it for a different purpose depending on our own need. You should understand why we are doing and what we are doing and how we are interpreting. That's all. Yes, can I proceed with the next tools of analysis? I should get yes from the participants. Okay. Yes, Merlina has responded. Thank you. Yes. Okay. Thank you, Shraddha Hivarale and Jacinta. Veda also. Thank you. Jelina Rani. Thank you for your responses. The participants who are responding, keep up the spirit of my presentation. Okay. So we move on to the next analysis. We have finished with the BLASTn analysis. Now I'm going to take you to the DNA subway analysis. It's a DNA subway project wherein we can analyze and the novel DNA sequences that is generated by the DNA sequencing experiment. Okay, I'll just type in the chat the web page which wherein you need to analyze. Type it twice. Yes, I wanted you to connect and do the analysis. Maybe I'll give you the sequences to be analyzed. Okay, I'll send the file to your mails. Okay, one second. I hope how to send it. It can be sent in WhatsApp, that'll be easier. DNA barcoding. One second. So you are able to connect to that website, participants?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. So I just sent the sequences for your analysis using your DNA subway. It is just a sequence that I have taken it from the from a paper. Please don't use it for publication or something. It is some other's work. Just for our analysis work, we are just doing it. Okay. So here I'm just, let me close the NCBI code on code and all other websites. One second. It's okay, I can close. We have finished the code on code aligner. We are now coming to the DNA subway. So before going into your DNA subway, you have to create an account. Okay, maybe I have given the steps to be followed. You can do it right now also. I have already done it. Yes, so here what you have to do is you have to click on the register link. I have already done it, so I need not register. So here you have to give the first name, last name, username. Just for a demonstration, I will not be submitting. You can register by yourself or you want to do it parallelly. Participants, please let me know. You can register later. Yes. You go to this web page, create your account. It will ask for stepwise. You need to give your mail ID. Once we are given that, you will get an email link. Likewise, I have already created it. I have a username and password. Can I proceed with analysis? Participants, you can register later. Is it okay? So I'm just logging in. Yes, I'm just logging in. Or you can use your guest role. Ma'am, now you are wanted, Abhina. You can use your guest role. So what you have to do is determine sequence relationship. Click on this. Determine sequence relationship. So here the sequence that I am using is a cytochrome oxidase G. So I'm just clicking on that cytochrome oxidase G and then I'm choosing the file sequences. So here I have given it in the WhatsApp group of the DNA barcoding workshop. If you need it, you can take it. It's not a trace file, it's a sequence file in the first format. Okay, and then what you do is I need to give a project title. I just give DNA barcoding demo. Okay, continue. Yes, so here it takes you step wise. Here you can just look at the sequence viewer. It shows what all sequences I have taken. So you might ask me a question, ma'am, what is the basis of all these sequences? The basis of all these sequences is after we do a blast, we'll take sequences which are closely related. All these sequences I have taken and kept it in the notepad so that I can proceed with the DNA subway. Okay, you can download the selected sequences in BLAST. It's very simple only. I hope all of you will be aware about it. Okay, and then so here it gives different results. V refers to it is ready, we can view. Then I go to sequence trimmer. Sequence trimmer is it will try to remove the longer sequences. It will try to keep all sequences within a similar length. Okay, and then if needed, you can go with the pair builder. Pair builder na, say here I have given, see all these are forward primers. Okay, if I have forward sequences, if I have forward and reverse, here also I can go with the pair building. Pair building wherein they will try to complement each other. Okay, I'm not doing this step. I hope it has to be done. Only if you go with the pair builder, it will work. Okay. And then consensus. Only if you do the pair builder, it will work. So I'm, for a demonstration purpose, I'm just selecting the top one, both the sequences. So here the idea is, well, if you have both the forward and reverse run, you can give it here. So both the sequences have been paired. It will ask us to save. You're able to see in the meet. Whatever I'm doing, one second, it has been held up. Okay, and now we go for the consensus builder. What is this consensus builder? I already showed you in the code on code aligner, wherein the sequences are being aligned. Okay, so here it shows, this is the, I paired two sequences. It just shows the consensus has been built up here. Consensus is wherein both the pairs are matching is being given. Trim consensus is when it is of extra length, all those extra lengths will be removed. Okay, this step is over. Then you proceed. Here also they give a BLASTian run. For each sequence we can do, say for example, I have many sequences together. I can do using this. For a demonstration purpose, I've just clicked on one of the BLAST, I have got the results. All these steps are put in the tutorial. You need not worry. So here, want me to repeat the previous step? Just one second. So here, I just clicked on BLASTian. Okay, want one, okay. First step, you go with the sequence viewer. Kalaimuni ma'am, you want me to repeat it again? So what you do is, we start with the, you have logged in. Once you have logged, I have logged in as Mahalakshmi Karthikeyan. So here I determine the sequence relationship. So what you do is, you first start with the project. My project. Only if you start with that, you'll be able to do the analysis. So here I have a DNA barcoding lab demo. I have uploaded the file. Now you go to the home for what to follow. See here, we have logged in. The first step is determine sequence relationship. So here, we need to give the sequences. I just clicked on, we have to click. We can give different types. As Shenparade ma'am was giving you an overview, what all genes can be given. So that has been given here. So as in this case, I have taken cytochrome oxidase. I just clicked on it and I'm just uploading the file. The same file is uploaded for you to work in the WhatsApp group. I just taken the laptop era sequences, okay, and then I need to give a title, DNA barcoding workshop virtual training. Okay, continue. Kalaivani ma'am, are you able to follow me? Okay. So we come to the stage. So I click on each of this is being shown as a flow chart. I just click on sequence viewer. It shows what all, see, I already done it. So it's showing large number. Okay. I was just trying to do it yesterday night. Okay, the sequence viewer is there. And then sequence trimmer is, sometimes when you take sequences on the database, a few of them will be lengthier. So what the sequence trimmer does, it tries to cut the extra length. It just keeps what all sequences have been aligning together. And then it asks for pair builder, wherein I just, in this case, you can do a pair builder only if you know both the sequences are complementary or both of them are closely related, okay? This is a same group, so I'm giving it as pair builder. Once you have adapted your pairs, you must save them, save. Only if it is paired, then you can go with the consensus builder. Or here, you can increase the pairs. Say for example, I just wanted to this also to be paired. So you can see when it has been paired, you are able to see the the checkboxes disappear. Persons are able to note, for every pair that I give, it considers it as a pair, and then it says, for your understanding, I've just clicked a few of them. We need to save. Am I too fast? Participants? Okay, so this consensus, once I have selected the pairs, it is going to the consensus builder. I'm clicking on the consensus builder. Consensus is the word, the bioinformatics term, which is used to confirm, that is, where the sequences are the same. Consensus is, it tries to compare two sequences and then tries to give the common base. That is what we mean by consensus. Okay, the consensus has been there. You can look at it. So here you can see, and it has given consensus, the base will be the same in both the sequences. Able to see? Participants? Feeling hungry, yeah? Not able to get any responses. Are you with me? Yes. Kalaimani ma'am, you've asked me a question. Why we need to pair the forward sequences? In this case, for demonstration, I've given Kalai ma'am. Normally, we'll be pairing only sequences which are closely related. Or it can be a forward run or a reverse run. Only then we are sure they have 100% identity or they have 99% identity, we'll pair them. Then only it can be taken for the analysis further. Kalai ma'am, have I answered your question? Yes. Thank you, sir. Deepak Kumar Trivedi, for your response. Okay. Okay. So I'll proceed with the analysis. So here we are just clicking on, the consensus builder is over, then we need to click on BLASTian. BLASTian can be done for all. I have taken many of the sequences, I'm just clicking for one. Yes, so it says running. So once the BLAST results are there, it shows the alignment. It's aligning for 1531. This is the Lemantrier dispar isolate cytochrome oxidase subunit G. E value is 0. Mismatches are 3. So here I just wanted you to note, when you have mismatches, you have checked the sequence quality, then it is a novel isolate. Okay. So here I'm just selecting a few. So what you are doing, once you have made your selection, you must add these BLAST hits to projects. So what I'm doing, I'm just trying to take sequences which have mismatches. Okay, 4, 5, 16. Mismatches is a base pair wherein there is a difference between the two, query and the sequences. Okay, so here you can see this is a distant group which is having 174 mismatches. This can be kept as an out group. In today's lecture, Reginald sir was giving an out group. Out group is an organism which we know which is distantly related. So here you can see it's having 174. This can be kept as an out group. Okay, and just what I'm doing for your demonstration purpose, I have just selected a few. If you are really doing, you have to look at to all the matches. What I am doing, I'm just adding the BLAST hits to the project. Okay, so all the BLAST hits has been there. Okay, we have selected the data. Okay, what we do, R refers to run. Okay, 1 second. One second, I missed a step again. Last time was the view the results. Need to upload it there.
Yes, I'm not able to select it here. That means the sequence have been uploaded. Okay. See, for example, if you have selected, you don't get the, it's been added there. Okay. Yes. I'm just adding the blast hits to the project. Okay, the data has been selected. So normally, if we need, we can keep a reference data. So reference data is, say for example, this is an insect group. What I do is Leptopteran. So what I give, I keep a reference data, common insects. Okay. So this has been added as a reference data. And then select the data. See, these are all the select. Maybe I can keep a few of them. This is already paired. Okay. Paired BJ81. And few of them I select. Or you can select all. It's up to us. I'll select all of them for you to understand. Select all. Save selections. Here you can download and keep the sequences as FASTA format also. Okay. Then what we do is we proceed with the MUSL. MUSL is a another multiple sequence alignment tool which does the alignment for all the selected sequences. Multiple sequences, whenever I have taken many sequences, if more than two, it is called as multiple sequences. I'll close this. One second. One second. Sorry, it has gone to the previous page. I'll go. See, I have closed my project. So as I already done it, it is in my project page. So here you can see. You can check that particular step. It will be in that page. So even if we close the window, you can go to your project and then take that particular activity. So here your MUSL results are view. V refers to view. It's ready to view. Yes. So it shows your sequence on alignment. Okay. Here you can see all these are closely related sequences. The others, these are distant related sequences wherein you can see a deviation. The alignment you can look in the JAL view. One second, it's opening. Make it open. Yes, what I have done is I have finished the multiple sequence alignment. As today, sir was talking about neighbor joining method and maximum likelihood method. This theory itself, it takes a longer time. I don't want to explain the theory, but just give the basics about it. The neighbor joining method is a method wherein they try to join the neighbors. Neighbors are those sequences which have minimum number of mismatches. The distant ones are those wherein the mismatches are higher. So when the mismatches are lesser, they'll be close neighbors. When the mismatches are high, they'll be distant neighbors. Okay. So based on the mismatches, the tree will be constructed. Today I was just trying. The neighbor joining method comes quickly, but this maximum likelihood method comes a little bit later. Maybe we can click on it, go for our lunch, and then later we can come and see the. So here, by just going into your DNA subway, you can just go with the viewer, trimmer, pair builder, consensus, and then you can also proceed with the MUSL. This is one method. Or otherwise, what we can do, we can go to the BLAST, download our own sequences, and you can proceed with the MUSL separately. That MUSL is also being given in the website. That can also be done. Okay, let it run. Any doubts related to this DNA subway? Am I making sense? Everyone able to follow? Okay, so here the Philip is ready for viewing. You can just click on it. You're able to see? So when I submitted my analysis, the sequence that I had in, these are the distant outgroups. So here you can see this diptera, fruit fly, chemiptera, all these are outgroups which comes as a separate lineage. Okay. This podoptera is also a separate group. These all others are leptopteran sequences. This BJ79 was my sequence. So what I can conclude is, okay, this BJ79 is closer to this DX575. Like this, I can narrow down my search and then I can also identify which is the closest taxon. Is it clear? These are the bootstrapping value that Reginald sir was mentioning in today's lecture. This bootstrap value is similar to our statistical analysis. Statistical analysis is, say for example, you say this much level of confidence. So similarly, if they give 90, it means that branching is highly reliable. But when they give a lesser value, that lesser value indicates it's not seen that much time. It's only seen 10 times when I do a bootstrapping. What they do, they slice, they randomly align, they take the sequence, put the sequence alignment in different regions and then construct the phylogenetic tree. When it is having a higher bootstrapping value, it indicates that lineage is clustered always. Because why you see this lineage is, all these are leptopteran sequences. So you can see that clustering 90 times. See? All these are leptopterans. Okay, 100. It shows this lineage is conserved. Whatever way you do, this lineage is seen 96 times. You can, I'll just highlight with the mouse. Okay. Similarly, all these sequences, they belong to their leptopteran. So this clustering is seen together. Am I clear? Yes, Dr. Divya, you have a question? You raised your hand. It's by mistake, huh? Dr. Divya. So what they do, they try to, we confirm whether the sequence is good and then we go for the database search results. We select the sequences. Okay, the sequences are selected based on our own choice. So here, when we select the sequences, the selection should be done with a rationale. We should see there are closely related sequences, and then we should also see some outgroup sequences. Outgroup sequences, say for example, I am working with a Lepidopteran group. What I do, it belongs to the insect group. Apart from the Lepidopteran order, I take some other group orders. So that when I construct a phylogenetic tree, the orders will be seen separate. Here you can see the top ones. These are all the Lepidopteran groups. This two letters, all these are Lepidopteran groups. And this is a Spodopteran group. Here you can see, based on the outgroup, I'm sure this is clustering as a separate lineage. And similarly, this dragonfly, grasshopper, all this belongs to the Orthoptera group. They are also clustered as a separate lineage. By using an outgroup, I'm sure whatever phylogenetic tree that I'm getting is reliable. The outgroup serves as a reference for us. Am I clear? Can I proceed with the next part of this, the last part of this particular analysis?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. So here, this maximum likelihood method. Yes. So this might take some time. Let it run. After it is run, maybe we'll come and see the results in the My Project page. So this is a DNA subway. It's not only used for phylogenetic relationship. It is used for other analysis also. But that doesn't fall under the DNA barcoding. So I've just taken this determining sequence relationship alone, which falls with the objectives of the DNA barcoding workshop. So starting with this, we get the sequence, do the databases, do the multiple sequence alignment, and get the closest neighbor. So here, this is a bit easier and user-friendly. So as beginners, you can try with your own sequence. If you don't have the sequence also, you can keep this knowledge, you can note down the website, later also you can try. One day if you use our own sequences, it will be really interesting for us to understand which is the closest sequence. Yes, participants, can I move on to the next part of this technical session?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
So we have finished with the DNA subway sequence. I already asked you to create a project. You can do it later. This we have finished. We have also finished with the NCBI BLAST. Okay. So whenever we do this part alone, I just wanted you to note one second. The key point. Whenever you are getting 100% identity, yes, it's not presented in the screen. Okay, let me present it. Let me present another part of the result, which is very important for us. Yes, you are able to see. So here, whenever you are getting BLAST results with 100% identity, it means it is already there. You need not proceed with the database. Maybe for us to, for as a scientist, you might be interested to get an accession number, you can proceed. But if it is lesser than 100%, it is a novel isolate, but it has to be checked for the sequence quality and sequencing errors. It's a very important point which you should note. If it is 100%, please don't say it is novel isolate. Okay, it means that the sequence is already available. Okay, so you have finished with the NCBI BLAST, wherein we are just checking for the sequence percentage identity. Based on the percentage identity, we decide whether the sequence can be given or not. Okay. Okay. Yes. Then this is what I showed you. We can also download the sequences. I hope you'll be already familiar with that. You want me to teach how the selected sequences need to be downloaded, or are already familiar? Participants, please let me know. If you want, I can just demonstrate, or if you are already aware about it, I'll move to the next part of this particular session. Please give your responses. Yes.
We are familiar, ma'am. So familiar.
Okay. Thank you. So here, in the results also, I showed you the DNA subway also. That's why I wanted you to note. If there are zero mismatches, it means it is the same. Okay. So in our analysis, when I showed you there was no zero mismatches, it means it is a new sequence which is having mismatches. Okay. So here, you should always understand if there are mismatches, it means we can proceed with the bold database wherein we will be getting a new barcode for our sequence. Okay, so here the more mismatches you have, it means that the sequence is unique. But you should also check for the sequencing errors. It's very important. I take some sequence which is full of sequencing error, and I say, ma'am, it is 90% or 70%. No, it is not be accepted. You should always check for sequencing errors, and then you also check for the assembly between the forward and the reverse sequence, and then if it is of a consensus, then you proceed with the database. If it is having mismatches, it's very good. It's indicating that the sequence is unique, and you can proceed further. Okay, and then you should also take into account the E value. If it is having a value of zero, it means it is not by chance. Okay, so next, can we proceed with the bold database? Familiar. Thank you, Kalaivani ma'am. Maybe all of them will be familiar with the sequence downloading. So I thought I can skip that particular step. Thank you. So can we proceed with the gold database? So the next things that we have to do in today's session is we have to search the bold database, wherein we'll be able to identify what is the species with the highest similarity. So here, this bold database. What is this bold database? It is a barcode of life data system. Here we have different ways. Maybe I can just give you the website. You can just try to search. Maybe you can continue in the afternoon session. The bold, the afternoon session, we have this bold database. I'll teach you what are all the different search methods that can be done with the board, and then I'll also already demonstrated about muscle. Muscle is it? I have just taught you with the DNA subway. If interested, you have another website also wherein you can do it by your own method also. That also I'll just give you a website link. If you are interested, you can try it outside. That's been given in the manual. You can do it as a stepwise. Okay. The afternoon session will proceed with the creating phylogenetic tree, BOLD. Now I give you a brief overview about BOLD. We'll start with the BOLD and then continue with the creating phylogenetic tree using Mega software and GenBank submission. Yes? Can I proceed with the BOLD database overview? Yes, I'll just
yes,
show
ma'am.
You a page.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. So here also you need to thank participants for their active involvement and their responses. It makes me feel happy. Okay, I'm just going to the BOLD database. Let me show you the link. So here also we need to create a link, create register here. Okay, so here I have already done the registration. So I have registered. Okay, so why we need this BOLD database? Any idea? What's the purpose of this BOLD database? Participants, please respond. Okay, maybe I'll just play a short video for you to watch. One second. I'll just play a short video. Myself always speaking. Let you can see another person talking. Hmm? Let me see. Are you able to see it in the? I need to present it. Yes, participants. So here, this BOL database. One second. So this BOL database, the teachers as well as the students can collaborate. That is, say for example, I have an MSc student or have my PhD student. What they do is they log in to their student portal and they try to submit all the data. I'll show you that website link. I've already shown it in the video. I'll also show it in that my own portal. You can see you are given a permission to upload your sequence file, upload your images, upload your map. All this you can do it as a student, and then as an instructor or as a teacher, as your guide is also given a login wherein she can approve the data, and that data can be submitted to the BOLD. So before we go to the BOLD database submission, we should do the whatever process I already mentioned. Get the sequence, assemble the sequence, correct if there are any errors, and in that it will also ask for trace files. Okay, so all this has to be done. So they are inviting, BOLD database is inviting the scientist community to collaborate and add data to the scientific community. So as professionals, we have the right to validate the data and submit. We cannot submit as and now. We need to validate the sequencing data, analyze it, and then submit it. Okay, I'll just show you a print screen of it, which I have logged in, so that you will get an idea. Maybe after you finish your lunch, you can log in to your BOLD database and keep it ready. Okay, so here for the BOLD, what you can do is I just show you my login. So here, this is my login. Mahalakshmi, I have logged in as my name. So here, I have logged in the teacher thing, wherein we can create a new project, okay? Or I can also see what all projects are already there, okay? So here, I haven't added any new projects as I don't have sequence now. I don't want to submit unnecessary sequence. So here, we can give a new data set. We can make it public, or you can make it as a private. When I give a public data set, it means it will be available to all the scientific community. When I make it as a private data set, it will be available only to myself. Okay. So here they give provisions to submit the upload the sequences, trace file, image file, primer, bibliography. All this can be done. Okay. So I was just working on this just to give a demo. I haven't submitted in the BOLD database, but it's just for you to note. So here we can proceed with the data set title. We need to give a data set title, a code. Code should be a letter. It should not be numbers. And then we need to describe about our data set and to make it whether it is publicly available or not. Okay. So when we log in our own portal, we are given the permission to view, analyze, and download the sequence data. Okay. So here, and when we log into this BOLD, we get this particular console. It is called as a workbench user console. Otherwise, I just wanted to look into the BOLD database. The BOLD database has all these. It is a public data portal wherein we get records, whatever data has been submitted in BOLD. Okay. So you can just, when I do a search, I'll be able to understand. Say, for example, I'm interested in leptopeptide group. I just wanted to, maybe I'll demonstrate it after the lunch. We just go and do a database search wherein try to see what are all the data which has been submitted worldwide. I can spot it out on the map and see who all have done it, where in the world they have done it. Okay. And then this Bing database, it gives the barcode index numbers. Okay. And then this also gives access to the publication. What are all barcode publication which can be utilized for our own research. And then this gives a primer database also as new users. If you are just venturing into our research, I might be interested to understand, to see what are all the primers that we are interested. So here it gives a list of all the primer data that has been available. Say, for example, I'm just interested in a Lepidoptera group. I can just give Lepidoptera. Searching. So here it gives what are all the Lepidoptera related primers available. You can select the primer data and do the analysis.